So good evening, guys. In today's session, I think yesterday's session was more into statproof and load calculation, mainly into gravity loads and lateral loads. Mainly, I focused on wind loads, right? So while talking about lateral loads, when you are designing a building, lateral loads are of two types, right? So it is wind load and seismic forces. So if you take, yesterday we have seen in detail how to calculate the wind load calculation as per IS 875 part 3, right? Today we are going to see more about seismic loading. How, what are the factors you have to consider while doing a seismic design? Okay, yeah. So the main objective in today's session will be how, what is a structure? How you have to plan a structure, right? So how you have to plan this structure for a seismic design, the irregularities which you have to concentrate on, the type of earthquake resisting system, more into ductility, and what are the codes that you have to refer for design. And I will be taking you through a model in ETABS. Today I will be just taking the screenshots from ETABS so that I can explain you clearly on how to do these models in ETABS, and morely I'm more focusing on the detailing part where you have to follow how to refer this IS 13920 to do the ductile detailing for seismic forces. Okay, so what is a structure? Okay, the main functions of a structure is to support, to contain inside it, and to protect. To explain in brief, if you take, what is that to support? To support something and hold it up. The main function of the structure is to support something and hold it up, to span the space between two objects so that they are connected. For example, let's take the legs of a chair. It is designed in such a way that it has to support the weight of the user who is using that chair, right? So that is how our structure also should function in the name of support. Okay, what is it to contain? That is to hold something that is not all over the place and to keep it apart from other things. Let's consider an example of a egg. The shell plays an important role there. It holds the inside material and protects it inside the egg, right? So that is how the structure has to be. It should be covered. So it should in itself cover all the functions that are inside the support. And if you take to protect, it is to protect the structure without any damage. We are asked to wear a helmet. Why? It is to protect our head. So the functions of the structure mainly is to support, to protect, and to hold the things inside that. That we have to keep in mind. So this is the basic structural system for a framed structure. If you see the components of a structure, this is a slab, this is a beam, this is a column, this is a foundation, and these walls will be the infill material. If you take the load path in a building is from slabs to beams, beams to columns, columns to foundation. So this is how the load path will be. So that's why when you are designing a building in a software, you will be designing in such a way that the slabs will be applying floor load for the slabs, beams you will be applying as an UDL, and columns you will be applying as a point load, which is getting directed to the foundation. Okay, walls is just an infill. And if you take like load bearing structure, then walls also plays an important role to transfer the load to the plinth, that is the beams that are below the walls. So let's see what is today I'm just completely going to cover about earthquake, because I can see a huge gap on seismic design in the with the budding engineers or who are working in the softwares. They know just the formulas of Bayes shear, and just they know how to design it, how to apply it in the model and get the analysis done. But they don't know the fundamentals of earthquake engineering, why it is, while doing the concept design, what are the criteria that that you need to consider. That is how to neglect the irregularities, how to place the columns, how to size the columns. I'm going to just explain in detail a portion of how you have to do the concept design for seismic buildings. So what is an earthquake? An earthquake is a sudden shaking of the earth's surface. The planetary crust, right? You know about an earth. So the planetary crust consists of series of plates that are in constant movement. And when stress builds on these plates and the plates get collided and extended. So when this stress is released, it radiates through the crust producing earthquakes, and tsunamis also are getting produced in the same way. So depending on the where they occur, these natural disasters have the potential to cause severe damage. Okay, during an earthquake, if you see, the ground moves rapidly back and forth in all the directions. Mainly it moves horizontally, but sometimes vertically also it gets moved. So when this is moving that way, what happens to the buildings during earthquake? You have to think of, if the when the ground moves rapidly back and forth, the foundations of the building are forced to follow these movements. Depending upon the movement of the ground, the foundations are also getting moved, right? So the upper part of the building, however, would prefer to remain where it is because of its mass of inertia. So this causes strong vibrations of the structure with resonance phenomena between the structure and the ground, and thus results in plastic deformation. Hope you might have remember about the plastic deformation yesterday, what I have taken through, right? So stress strain curve and plastic deformation of the structure. Okay, and the substantial damage with local failures mostly there will be a substantial damage with local failures. In extreme cases only it will get collapsed. So you have to properly model a building. That is, in the concept stage itself, you have to properly plan a structure in such a way that it doesn't get collapsed when you come up with an earthquake or ground motion. So buildings must therefore be designed to cover considerable uncertainties and variations. Okay, so next is the seismic design. So earthquake loads are known as seismic loads. Okay, this is the terminology. Seismic is a terminology for earthquake. So these types of loads causes movement of the foundation of the structure. Okay, earthquake forces are internal forces that developed on the structure because of ground movements. Since we have lateral, since these are lateral forces, we have provided arrow marks like this. So this causes internal forces to develop, and this produces ground motions, okay, ground movements. So there is, when there is an earthquake, three mutual perpendicular forces act on a structure during an earthquake. Okay, two are horizontal, that is the because of the dead load and live load, that are two horizontal forces which acts in opposite directions. Okay, two horizontal forces which acts in opposite directions, and one vertical forces due to the weight of the structure. That is the dead load of the structure. Therefore, the horizontal forces acting on the structural elements are proportional to the. So these horizontal forces are proportional to the mass of the whole. So only when we are designing the seismic forces, we consider it as a mass while modeling also we take the mass into consideration. Okay, so this is directly proportional to the mass of the structure. As vertical forces does not affect much during earthquake, whereas this opposite horizontal forces result in movement of the building during earthquake. So these two horizontal direction forces are considered in the design while doing a seismic design. Okay, so and also due to inertia, additional forces on the structure develop on the superstructure, not on the substructure. It develops on the superstructure. Substructure is the foundation. Okay, the impact of an earthquake on structure depends on the stiffness of the structure, soil type, location, and height of the structure. These are the most governing factors that you need to consider for an earthquake force. Okay, and the horizontal direction force, that is the lateral force, are considered in the designing of earthquake for a building. Okay, next is, what is the difference between seismic? Because seismic and wind forces are the lateral forces. And when you are designing a building in a place, any place, say if it is Chennai or Gujarat. In Chennai, if you consider, it is in seismic, it is not in, it is in seismic zone 3 area, right? So it is not that critical zone. But if you are building a same kind of height of building in Gujarat, it is seismic zone 5 area, which is prone to high seismic forces. So you have to design that building for a critical case of critical load case of seismic. And in Chennai, you can design it for a critical load case of wind, because this will be the wind design will be the dominant in Chennai. But in Gujarat, the same project, it will be dominant for seismic. So when you are designing a building, only one lateral forces will be taken into consideration. And also when you check the load combinations, you will not mix the seismic design and the wind design together. You will combine the dead load, live load, seismic load, and dead load, live load, wind load, and dead load and live load are separate combinations. You can just go through your IS 456 and see. Nowhere in the code book they will not mix the combination of seismic load and wind design. So the building, when designing a building for lateral forces, you should consider only one dominant case, either seismic or wind. You have to check for the worst load combination and you have to design the building accordingly. Got it? So let me take you through the difference between seismic and wind design. Okay, the loads acting on a structure are mainly the vertical and lateral loads. That we know that we have two loads, vertical and lateral loads. So the vertical load mainly consists of the dead load, live load, and snow load. And the behavior of the structure when subjected to these vertical loads is more or less the same. But if you take the lateral load, it is of seismic load and wind load. And the application of these forces and behavior of the subject and behavior of the structure varies for these forces. If you take the seismic load, it is like it depends on the mass of the structure. Okay, and if you take the wind force, it depends on the exposed area. If you remember yesterday, we applied the forces on the columns. That also we applied it for the external columns. If you have internal columns also, you won't apply loads, wind loads in the internal columns, only for the area which is exposed outside. Okay, second point is seismic forces will be distributed along interior and exterior frames and columns in a structure. That is that it acts as the location of masses. So the whole structure acts for the seismic load. But in wind force, only the exposed frames only is applied with wind forces. A structure having lesser mass will perform good during earthquake. If you what does it mean is, since it attracts lesser load and the exposed area has got no influence on the performance during seismic effects. If you take in the case of wind load, their structure having higher mass will resist the wind load effectively, and the structure having lesser surface area will perform better since it attracts lesser wind load. Okay, if the surface area is less, it attracts only less wind load. So that is the difference between a seismic and a wind load in terms of area. So in terms of stiffness, if the stiffness of the structure influences the seismic force developed, and in wind, there will not be any influence because of wind. And main thing is the base shear. If you take the, I think you might have learned about a base shear formula. We will be looking at the end. So the base shear value is more at bottom and it decreases as it, when you go floor by floor, the base shear value gets the bottom base shear value will be more, and when high, and it decreases as height increases. Okay, if you take in the case of wind force, it increases as height is increased, because yesterday we saw, no, for different heights we have a different set of table that needs to be followed. So depending upon the height, length and width of the building, the wind force changes. So if you take the damping is covered in the calculation of is considered in the calculation of seismic forces, but in the case of wind forces, we don't consider the damping force, damping ratio or anything related to the building. Okay, for seismic force, it is generated at the base of the structure, but wind force, it is generated in the exposed area. Okay, so now I think, and main one more thing is seismic force are also dependent on the soil type. Okay, the it of also the soil type also affects its performance, but it doesn't, the soil type will not have much effect on wind forces. Okay, so how are the seismic forces measured? So the main criteria for measuring the seismic forces are acceleration, displacement, duration, and magnitude. So what is this acceleration? So I think you hope you might have all studied, right? Acceleration is the rate of change of speed measured in g, that is gravity, g 9.8 meter per second square, which is the acceleration of gravity. Okay, and displacement is the distance from one from the point of rest that is measured in the, so how much the building has displayed from one point to another point, how much it is displayed, that is what the displacement is. Velocity, the range of the rate of change of position measured in centimeters or mm per second, so that is what the velocity is. And duration, how much duration the shaking of the earth is caused, how much the ground motions, how much minutes it has lasted for, whether it is for 10 seconds or 20 seconds, so that is what the duration. And you might all aware of the Richter scale to measure the intensity of earthquake, so that is the magnitude, whether it between what range it is, whether it is from 1 to 10, so that is what the magnitude is. The destructive power of an earthquake is determined by the acceleration and the duration. Okay, generally the longer an earthquake lasts, the less acceleration a building can withstand. The main factor is the acceleration and the duration. Okay, next is strategy of seismic design. What all the points that you have to consider while doing a seismic design? So the traditional earthquake resistant design philosophy requires normal buildings, take any building, normal building, not so hi-fi with glasses, and take a normal building that should be able to resist minor shaking with no damage, which means when a earthquake is causing, there should be a minor shaking, but no damage to the structural and non-structural elements. We can feel that shake, but it should not damage the structure and non-structural element. When you consider the second point you have to consider is the moderate shaking with minor damage. Even though if the magnitude is heavy, there can be a minor damage, but the structural element and the whole building should not get collapsed. And in the case of severe shaking, how the structural element will withstand with no collapse to save life and property inside the and the adjoining buildings. So these three things you have to always think of while designing. This is the design strategy you have to keep in mind for doing a seismic design. Okay, so for which you have to follow for certain criteria. Okay, earthquake magnitude, the magnitude, this is the Richter scale reading that I have shown here. So normally the earthquake magnitude vary based on the location of the building. So weak earthquakes are frequent, but very strong earthquakes are rare. It happens only 50 to 100 years. And mild and moderate earthquake forces are considered in service limit state. You might have heard about two kinds of design, right? Limit state design and working stress design. So we have to design it for service limit state of serviceability. You have some load calculations, that is that which doesn't allow any damage. And if you take the ultimate limit states, limit state of collapse, you have different, yesterday itself I told you to refer for load combinations. There are three criteria: limit state of collapse, serviceability, and damage, right? So that depending upon that, the load combinations needs to be considered. Okay, and also if you see the strategy of an engineer earthquake design, if a building has more stiffness, it will have more brittle nature, and eventually the fail will with higher seismic oscillation. So any building in seismic zone should be designed considering the stiffness and flexibility in adequate proportion. So when you're designing a building, you should consider the stiffness criteria and the flexibility. So that is the elastic nature that you have to consider while designing a seismic design building. this for seismic design of buildings. Okay, now let's see the four virtues of earthquake resistant buildings. So these are the four virtues to be followed in an earthquake resistant building. So first one is the good structural configuration. So the architects may come up with any kind of specification for a building, right? So to avoid architectural form that is detrimental to good earthquake performance and that does not introduce any further complexities in the building behavior. So when an architect is coming up with a plan, you should ensure that there are not much irregularities, there are not much any soft stories. You have to clearly look on with the cantilever, how much it has provided, everything should be cleanly noticed so that you come up with a good structural configuration. Second one is minimum lateral stiffness. Because of this proper concept planning, building concept structural system is formed, which has to deliver minimum lateral stiffness in each of its plan directions, that is uniformly distributed in both plan directions of the building, so that there is no discomfort to occupants of the building and no damage to contents of the building. And third one is the lateral strength. A minimum lateral strength in each of its plan directions, that is uniformly distributed again in both the plan directions of the building, to resist low intensity ground shaking with no damage and not too strong to keep the con. And we have to also keep a check on the construction cost. All these designs should not increase the cost of the building. Okay, so you have to also consider the construction cost. Okay, and finally, the good overall ductility. You have to consider the ductility, a main point while designing for seismic forces. So what is this ductility? If you are to accommodate the imposed lateral deformation, it has to be well distributed along the desired mode of deformation at an ultimate limit state. So good structural configuration is achieved by conceptual seismic design. So there should be minimum lateral stiffness, minimum lateral strength, and minimum, that is overall ductility is mandatory for survival of any building during an earthquake. So these are the four virtues that you need to consider while designing a building. So there are some, we have come up with many earthquakes, right? So there are some lessons learned from the past earthquakes. So every earthquake is of different form. So as a collection of the results of different earthquakes, we understood some lessons learned. That are the lessons learned from past earthquakes, okay? All earthquake design parameters are derived based on the past earthquake impacts only. If you take our Indian earthquake design code, is revised after the Bhuj earthquake in Gujarat. It happened, right? So it was revised after that. Even very similar earthquakes did not damage few buildings which were not designed for seismic. They survived only because of its good structural configuration. If you see, many buildings have standard still for earthquakes on worst scenario because the structural configuration was good. And the conservative design does not work in that case. The right amount of things needs to be provided for a proper structural configuration. And inelastic deformation was accompanied by severe reduction in strength, severe damage, which causes severe damage or collapse. Okay. And all modes of inelastic deformation are not equally viable. Some lead to failure, and others provide ductility. So you should be taking care on this inelastic deformation also. Some places it will be, it will collapse, lead to failure. Some places it provides ductility. Okay. This is a view of an building collapse that happened in the past earthquake because of weak column and strong beam issue. If you see in the bottom, the whole building has collapsed because the columns were not strong. If you see the beams, it has not collapsed. This collapse is mainly due to the columns. So if you design our building with weak column, strong beam concept, the columns will fail first. that leads to complete collapse of the entire building during earthquake. Next concept is the strong column weak beam advantage. In this case, if you the beams are strong, but the columns, no, it's not that much strong. So if you see, if we design our building with strong column weak beam, if you see the beams are only not that heavy like what you have considered, but the columns are strong, that produces a displacement. Okay, so if you design a building with a strong column weak beam concept, the beams will fail first. That will impact only the corresponding level and not the entire building. So the building is safer than the earlier case. So this building is totally collapsed. In this case, the building is safe. So with this concept, the plastic hinges will develop in the beams only. We get plastic hinges developed here, okay? But the building will not get collapsed. So let's see about the, the right kind of sizing of beams and columns also needs to be considered in this case as well, designing a column and a beam, okay? What is conceptual seismic design? Before going on to modeling phase, the initial arrangement of elements and vertical and horizontal floor configuration should be dealt with care. That is the columns and beams, we should take special care. If the building configuration and structural arrangement is perfect and regular with respect to the code guidelines, the building will react minimum to any earthquake. So there should be a structural simplicity to be followed. There should be uniformity, symmetry, and redundancy in plan. There should be uniformity along height. That is, if you are following a 4 feet or 3.5 feet height difference between floors, there should be an uniformity in that. It should not be like you follow 5 to 6 feet in one floor, and then again in the next floor, you are going with 3.5 feet, then again 6 feet. That also develops an irregularity in the building. Okay, and you should follow proper bidirectional resistance and stiffness, also torsional resistance and stiffness, and diaphragmatic behavior of the story level. So you should take special care on how the each story will behave for the lateral forces applied, and also there should be an adequate foundation that needs to be provided. So nowadays we have moving foundation where the we provide diaphragms and we provide bearings so that the base is fixed, base isolators, so that the whole building gets isolated from the base. That is a new technique that we are coming up for seismic design of buildings. Okay, so if you take, I'm talking about this irregularity for a long time. So let me take through this irregularity, what it is. Okay, due to practical constraints, some buildings will have some irregularities. Right, the irregularities may be due to plan, elevation, structural member position, and occupancy also. And soft story irregularity and torsional sensitive floor irregularity are two worst irregularities that a building comes up with. See, if you take, for example, this is a building, you have a basement parking, you have a floor continuously. Okay, this works fine. If you have an, if you are planning for a parking here in intermediate to these two floors, that creates a soft story. Okay, so in that case, it is not a proper design that we are providing. Maybe you can provide 2-3 levels of parkings and then you can go on with the upper story. But this soft story, there will be a large displacement between foundation and first floor if you are providing a soft story like that. Okay, so the types of irregularities, that is what we are going to see. So if you see the irregularity type criteria, there will be a symmetrical building in both X and Y direction. That is what normally is a very, that is a rectangular shaped building. That is what normally it is preferred. There should be torsional flexibility, means torsional insensitive building is preferred to avoid twist in building. That helps to avoid the twist in the building. And more offsets and cutouts in a floor will lead to irregular seismic response. If you have more openings or more cutouts in the intermediate floors, it will lead to irregular seismic response. And random arrangement of beams is vulnerable to smooth seismic load transfer. So if you are providing properly the beams and columns in such a way the load transformation, that is the load transfer from beams to columns, also will happen properly, and the fixedity of the building also helps to help the building from earthquake movement. Okay, so if you take for example, let me take you through this plans, that is different buildings that you can see here. If you see this, this is a simple plan where you have equal columns and beams as a framed structure distributed. Okay, in the second case, if you see, there are lot of curves and corners, here a corner, here a corner. So in this case, no, you won't be able to provide a proper column beam tying, or some irregularities is there. If you see, there is no proper fixedity in the building plan. So we have to avoid as much as possible. Maybe you can just plan some columns in front of this, and you can make it as a different kind of structure also. So that helps us to prevent a little bit of seismic effect on the, or lateral forces acting on the building. And if you see here, this is the expansion joint that is provided between two buildings. And if you see, mostly as per CODEL norms, if you are going more than 45 meters of length, you have to provide an expansion joint. Okay, so that needs to be followed. And also shear wall system, in case of any normally nowadays what we follow is, if it is an RC column beam framed structure, we go on with the shear wall system, where this shear wall is a full RCC wall. We normally provide it in the lift or staircase area. Okay, so this system is widely followed in this in many high-rise buildings. Okay, so if you see here, it is a soft story building and we don't have any columns here, so this is not at all a good design of a building. Okay, so you should plan in the concept stage. Even though the architects come up with new concepts, you should check the feasibility for lateral loads and vertical loads. You can always add on, you can increase the size of the columns or beams, but when it comes to lateral loads, you have to take special care during the concept design itself. Okay, so any queries till this, guys? If you have any queries, you can please let me know the chat box. Yeah, soil was also one of the reason for earthquake damage. That's what I told you, no? Soil is also one of the criteria for earthquake. That is mainly because of the ground motion. Okay. That depends upon the, you have asked for two buildings of same kind. It depends upon the structural placements, how you have placed the columns and beams again. Okay. The soil becomes old, the foundation doesn't become hollow. It is like the soil also plays an important part in designing, because if you take seismic, as I said, the ground motion happens in the soil level, right? So it plays an important role, but the foundation doesn't become hollow because if the failure of the foundation is mainly because of soil erection, something like that. It doesn't happen because of ground. It has become, the foundation doesn't goes hollow. Okay, so that's why before doing a foundation design, in today's session we are not covering pipe track wind load calculation here. So if you take any if you are planning to design a building, please do ensure to do a geotechnical test for the soil to understand the safe bearing capacity of the soil, to understand the soil type, whether it is clayey soil or whether it is a very good soil. To come up with the foundation type, you have to be aware of the soil condition. Okay. Okay. Now let's go to the types of earthquake resisting system. We have different types of earthquake resisting system. Here we are going to see about the moment resisting frames. Okay. In moment resisting frames, if you see, the joints or connections between the columns and beams are designed to be rigid, And this causes the columns and beams to bend during earthquake. So these structural members are designed to be strong in bending. If you take this, the columns and beams are strong in bending. Okay. So these frames and are, if you take a steel building, these frames are trusses without diagonal bracings. So the shear force acting on the structure must be resisted as moments in the joints between beams and columns. And these moment resisting frames are called special moment resisting frames because of this additional requirement. And also it gets improved the inelastic response characteristics. Okay. There are two types of moment resisting frames. One is ordinary moment resisting and second one is the special moment resisting. If you take the ordinary moment resistant frame, these frames are unable to meet the specification requirement of a ductile behavior. Nowadays, we are, if the building is designed for seismic forces, we are providing ductile reinforcement detailing for these kind of design to play an important role in ductility. I will be explaining what are the points that you have to follow for transverse reinforcement, how you have to plan your ductile reinforcement detailing. Okay. And usually in ordinary moment resistant frame, usual building frame constructed with a closed system. Like I said, it will be a beam column structure and the bending moment will not be an issue. If you take special moment resisting frame, right, these frames are capable of meeting special detailing, that is the ductile detailing. And it satisfies very well for earthquake design. Okay, so the for these types of earthquake, the ideal plane frame should be these things you have to keep in mind is the constant, the whole, the beam depth should be constant all over the story. Okay, it should not be like 900 mm or 750 at play, some places in one bay of beam itself, you should not vary the depth of the beams. And there should be constant size of in each column in all stories. And approximately uniform spans. Try to maintain uniform spans as much as possible if you are going to design any building on a critical zone seismic area. And the interior columns of approximately of the same size so that you can plan the exterior columns in a different sizes if you want. And interior columns, if you are following it as 900, like 750 by 750 or 450 by 450, please ensure that you make it the same as much as possible and approximately the same height to be followed. Like I said earlier, don't follow like 6.5 feet for a floor and 3.5 feet for the other floors and just keep on changing the floor heights. Try to maintain a proper floor height so that it is easy to calculate the mass of the structure. So what are the advantages and disadvantages of moment resisting frame? So if you take the advantages, the frames, they won't disturb. If you go on with a moment resisting frame, no need to disturb the architectural interest, the plan of the architect. You don't want to disturb. There is no use of disturbing their architectural plan a lot. And the cost effective also, the costness of the building construction also will be very less. It is more cost effective for a medium rise building. Okay. And concentric connections and regular geometry have well known and understood seismic performance. If you take the disadvantages, you have to go on with a flexible this RC wall system. Next we will be seeing about the RC wall system, that is the shear wall system. If you go on with the shear wall system, this is not flexible. That is, the flexibility criteria should be regularized, right? So it is not that much as an RC wall system, and it is prone to soft story failure, like how I said about soft story concept, right? And not suitable and not cost effective for high rise buildings. If you are going on with a high rise building, then this kind of moment resisting frame structure is not a good option. So this is what an shear wall, RC wall system that I was talking about. If you are constructing any RC wall, that is reinforced concrete, this is a like a full, this will be full reinforcement bars with concrete, like a typical column is what this shear wall acts like, but the, it will not be as thickness of the, like the column, but width will be more than a column. That is what a shear wall. I think you might be aware of what a shear wall is. You might have learned in your college days also. If a building consists only RC wall to resist all seismic load, it is called an RC wall system. Okay, to in some places we go on with an RC wall, shear walls. So if it is those kind of concepts, then it is a shear wall system, RC wall system. And besides their main role as a gravity load resisting system, frames of beams and columns double as earthquake resisting systems. In fact, that frames are the most common type of such systems in concrete buildings. If you take any concrete building, no, the main criteria is the columns, beams, slabs. It is like not a steel building. The any framed structure, if you are going for an RCC kind of structure, the main thing is slab, column, beams. Okay, and almost all buildings nowadays are designed for this dual system only, that is the column, beam, shear wall. If you are designing an earthquake type building, then normally they go on with the shear wall in the lift core, because it goes throughout the building, right? Or in the staircase part, if you see any tall building concepts that is followed in an IT building, you can see a shear wall in the lift core or in the staircase floor area or in a specific area where a shear wall will be, concept will be followed. So those kind of system is called a dual system, where RC columns, beams and shear walls are there. Okay, so now we are getting in through the ductility. So this, it is a character of flexibility of the building, okay? And it in ductility, a building can undergo large deformation with application of lateral load without any considerable reduction in the strength of the building, okay? So, the ductile behavior of a building is normally followed in the form of drawings as per IS 13920. Which suggest reinforcement design and detailing requirements based on the research. So this ductile reinforcement is mainly to be followed. If you are providing an RCC design for ductile detailing, then IS 13920 should be followed. That is the Bible for ductile detailing. Okay, and the design seismic force are approximately inversely proportional to the global displacement ductility. Therefore, increasing the available of global ductility reduces the internal forces for the dimension of structural members. Okay, even if the earthquake greater than the design occurs, the ductility property of the building will help dissipation of the excess energy through lateral deformation. Even if you are having a heavy earthquake magnitude, if the earthquake occurs, for this ductility criteria helps severe collapse of the building at that point of time. Okay, so how this earthquake is building is designed as per IS 1893. So hope everybody is aware of this. What I suggest to all students who are participants here is, please be thorough with the codes. That is IS 456 for what it is used, IS 800 for what it is used, IS 875, part 1 is for dead load, part 2 is for live load, part 3 is for wind load, part 4 is for snow loads, and what is the load combinations, which codes you will be referring for load combinations, and for seismic, what is the load you have to consider for design, it is IS 1893. For ductile detailing, what is the code you have to refer, it is IS 1392. What is the code for normal detailing of RCC beams and columns, SP16. So all these codes you have to be aware of, and these numbers you have to be keeping it in mind while you are going to attend any interview, because these are the concepts which will help you to crack the interview. Okay, so when you see this IS 1893, In this, Indian code provides procedure for both static method and dynamic method. In this IS 1893, if you see, both static method and dynamic method is also covered. If you take this dynamic method, it involves too much of analytical and numerical calculations, and that's why we require a computer assistance. If you take the static method, it is simple to calculate by using some formulas and what are the specifications that needs to be considered. So if you take the design, seismic design force here, seismic design codes represents earthquake induced inertia forces in the form of design equivalent lateral forces. Okay, so this is how I told you, this is how we provide the seismic forces that is applied for all these stories. This is how we apply the seismic forces to each story. Okay, and if you take how to calculate this design seismic design force, it is the design code represents the earthquake induced inertia forces in the form of design equivalent static lateral force. This force is called seismic design Bechier. You might be aware of about the Bechier that you might have design Bechier formula. VB is equal to AHW, where AH is equal to ZI. I think you might be aware of this formula if I take you through that code. IS 1893 code. Here, this is the design Bechier that I was talking about, that VB is equal to AH into W. So, this is how you calculate. I will take you through all the important abbreviations, that is the notations that is specified here, so that you get an idea on after watching this after completing this meeting, you can just go on, see, refer your IS code, so that you get much more clarity on how, what is this natural period, what is this VB, what is this W, seismic weight, and all those things. Okay, so if you see this VB, Z is the seismic zone factor, I is the importance factor, natural period of the building, that is a time period, and R is the response reduction factor. So this is what the formula, what I was telling about for design Bechier. And this I've taken from the IS code, IS 1893. Okay. And the design Bechier VB is calculated by AH into W, where AH is the ZI by 2R, SA by G into W, where Z is the seismic zone factor. We have different zones here, zone 2, zone 3, zone 4, and zone 5. Zone 1 is completely removed from the code after the Gujarat earthquake. No, we don't have zone 1 now. Only it starts from zone 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so this is how it is differentiated by color. These are all zone 2, where it is not a critical zone. Zone 3 is these areas. Okay, and zone 4 is these northern part of India, and zone 5 is somewhere in Gujarat and all those things areas. So when you are designing a building for zone 5 and zone 4, you have to take special care, and these value of VZ is what you have, you can see in this table. Okay, you can always refer this table in the code book also. It is, I have taken these values from the code IS 1893 part 1. Okay. And if you take about, let me take you through the notations used in this formula. Here, Z is the seismic zone factor, which depends on the severity of the earthquakes in the locality. So that is what this value we are taking out. It is a factor to obtain the design spectrum depending on the maximum seismic risk categorized by maximum considered earthquake, okay, in the zone in which the structure is located. So in which area you are going to design the building, the zone seismic zone Z value needs to be considered depending upon that. And the basic zone factors included in the standard are responsible estimate of effective peak ground acceleration, and these values are come up, we have come up with these values depending upon the peak ground acceleration. If you take I, that is the importance factor, this depends on the building functionality, whether it is a school building or a college building. And if you see in IS 1893, you can see this I value depending upon the, you can just go through this code in detail so that you understand what are the things you need to consider for, it's loading. Yeah. So if you can see, This is the RC framed building. How this is the value for time period, that natural time period you have to consider, that is for TA. And for steel building, this is the value you have to consider. And everything depending upon this is what we are taking for design. Okay, see, if you are, it's a load masonry wall building, what is the values you have to consider for R? All these values are provided in IS codes. This is where we have to refer and take the values for design.
Okay, so if it is an irregularity type, what is the importance factor that you need to consider for hospital building? I told you, right? Now we were talking about importance factor. This depends upon the functionality of the building. So if it is an hospital, school or emergency building, fire stations, railway station, then you have to take an importance factor of 1.5. Apart from the buildings listed here, all other buildings you can consider one. So it is a, this is a factor used to obtain the design seismic force depending on the functional use of the structure. And it is also categorized by hazardous consequence of its failure, posed earthquake functional need. Okay, and these values are calculated depending upon the occurrence of the earthquakes. Okay, and time period T of the building is directly proportional to the, and time T is directly proportional to the building height and inversely proportional to the plan dimension. If you take R, this response reduction factor, I showed you earlier, right? For the type of the building, how you have to. This is the ratio of the design of shear base shear to the generated base shear. Okay, this factor by which the actual base shear force that would be generated in the structure. And generated in the structure and remains elastic due to its response for design basis earthquake. And this value can be reduced to obtain the design lateral force. So these are the, this is the main formula that you need to understand for design base shear. And these are some of the notations that you have to refer the code books IS 1893 for which the values are needs to be considered. So now I'm taking you through a model in ETAPS. Here in the in today's model, I've just taken a screenshot from the ETAP so that you get still more clarity on how it is used and how we are coming up with.
Yeah, shear walls may be of any thickness. Yeah, shear wall acts as an outer wall also, but sometimes we provide shear walls in the interior. We take it through a full line segment where it covers the interior wall. So if the lift core wall is in the interior, then it is like we provide shear walls in the interior interior of the building also. Yeah. It depends upon the lateral force that we are working on, Veera. Height of the building is more, wind velocity will vary, and then how we can design the building. Any factor to be considered. The height of the building is more than 30 meters, then the wind. Yeah, wind velocity mainly depends upon the place, location, right? Wind speed. Yesterday we saw, right, for the what wind speed, for depending upon the location, what is the wind speed, and for height, mainly wind forces is calculated depending upon the height, width, and length of the building.
This is also again an I think my screen is visible now. Yeah, so this is again an software which is used for structural analysis and modeling. Okay, so now this will be, once you enter into the software, first thing you have to do is to provide the display unit, that is in what unit. If you are, the client has provided you a drawing in meters or mm or feet and inches, you have to just select the units here and what are the codes you have to refer, that what are the codes you are using for designing this building. Whether it is steel building means it's IS 800. If it is RCC design means IS 456. And then you have to just click on OK. Okay, so this is how you start the program and this is how the start page will display. So if you click on new model, this is how the image of model initialization form will display. Okay, this is how the first step you have to enter into ETAPS. So next is the model quick template. Okay, here all these things, how you, the different types of forming the model is what you can, different structural objects and how you will be forming the model. That is the number of grids in X direction, how to form the number of grids in Y direction, how the spacing of grids in X direction and Y direction. Okay, so this is how I have modeled using a grid. Okay, so my I have taken into consideration my plan in this way. This is the easiest way of creating a model in grid system in ETAPS. Okay, so the number of grids in X direction will be 4. In this is the X direction and this is the Y direction will be 4, and spacing of grids will be 24. I have here taken as feet and inches. Okay, and my number of stories is 4, and all the stories are of 12 feet, typical height story. Okay, all are all same height. Okay, second is the story data. So in this, to review the current story definitions, you have to click on the edit menu, and then you can edit the stories. So if you see, this is the base of the building, from where the plinth level will be 1.5 height, and there will be an increase of 3 feet height in the building. All over, throughout the building, there will be a 3 feet height. So the plinth, from plinth it is 3 feet height, so 4.5, again it is 3 feet height, so 7.5, again it is 3 feet height. So this is how I have done it. Okay, and the plinth and the first floor, I have kept it similar, and all the columns and beam positions are also similar. I have not changed anything. So if you are changing anything in the, apart from the first floor, if you are changing some dimensions, then you have to change the value here. Okay, so it is not the same to the first floor, you have to specify. Okay, so, and you can also come up with a story color. On this form, you can just click modify and also clear the, and also change the story data. Okay, this is how the third step you have to do. So first you have entered into, you have provided the units, then you have come up with the grid spacing, and then you have given the story data. Next is the frame properties. So here in frame section, what you have to do is, you have to go and click on the menu, and there you have section properties in which you have to select the frame. In that, you have to select what is the property of this building, whether it is a steel building, whether it is a composite beam, whether it is a concrete beam or concrete column, or a steel beam or a steel column. So what type of building you are going to design, that is where you have to select that, and you have to give it add, copy or modify, and just click on OK. Okay, so with that, you will be coming up with a, and if you want to create a new one, just click import new properties, and then you have, you can get the new properties imported here. Okay, so next is the quick draw objects. Here in quick draw objects, you can draw column buttons to you can, this is the icon that you have to use to develop or draw a modeling column or beam. Yesterday also I showed you a cursor in StatPro to draw a beam, right? So in ETABS, this is the, ETABS is a very user-friendly software than StatPro. But the only thing is, normally they use it for high-rise buildings or concrete building design. Normally ETABS is used for these kind of buildings only. So using this icon, you can just provide, you can create these draw beams or draw columns, and you can come up with a column and building. And the properties of the object in the columns will be displayed also. You have to just click on the lower left hand, and then you will get it displayed. So this is the load assigning, load patterns, that is the loads that we are assigning for a model. Okay, so here there are different kinds of loads. Again, go to menu, load patterns, you have to just click. You have to, if it is a dead load, you have to just click on a dead load, and the self weight is considered normally as 1. And the, since I'm designing this building for IS 1893, you have a auto load combination generated in ETABS. Okay, you have to just click on the IS 1893 2006. So the normal load combinations with respect to IS 1893 gets displayed. Okay, for that you have to provide dead load, live load and earthquake, that is the seismic load. Okay, and just give add new load. Okay, then the load gets created. Next is the applying shell loads. So here this load pattern I've just shown for live load alone. Here you will be applying an UDL of for the walls, for the wall loads will get transferred to the beams, right? So you will be calculating, as a dead load, you will be providing it for the beams. This live load will be acting as
as a floor load, where you can, if it is, if the building is for hall or meeting purpose or staircase, depending upon the codal provision IS 1875 part 2, you have to refer that values and you have to apply this and give apply and okay. Okay, you have to just select the members for which you are providing. So this is an important one where you are providing the applying the frame loads. Okay, here again, you have to go to the loads tab and you have to click on the frame loads. Here you can apply it as a distributed load or point load for the beams. And also you can edit the loading values. You have to just apply it, whether it is a gravity load or a lateral load, you have to just specify it. And whether it is a force or a moment, normally it is a force. And at which point, if it is a trapezoidal load, at which point you have to apply, you have to provide. Here it is an uniform load, so I provided at 10. And just give it, apply and close it off. These are the different frames that are available in ETAPS, and you can see different profile frames here, right? So these you can just click on which profile you want, and you can just make the model depending upon the frames you wanted, and you can just apply it, and you can just analyze the model. And because we have provided the we have created the model, applied the loads, load combinations, and we have done the analysis, the frame analysis for the whole model. So here, this is what the important part I thought of covering here, because this is how the output of the model that I have created comes up, right? So you will be having, this is the AST that we got in this design for the analysis and design. So if you take this single beam, right? If you take the single beam, any single beam, this is the bottom reinforcement. I am taking the beam between B and C, okay? The top reinforcement is 1449. 369, and at the corner is 1478. This is the AST that we are getting from the output. And for bottom reinforcement is 724, 816, and 739. This is at the corners and this is at the middle. So you have to come up with the reinforcement. That is whether you need to provide three numbers of 20 or three numbers of 16, or that calculation helps you to come up with. I think hope you are all aware of that calculation, right? For pi by 4 d square, where d square, d is the diameter of the bar. So for 12 mm dia rod, what is the AST? I think you will be aware of, like, right? So 113 mm square is the AST for 12 dia rod. If it is 16 dia rod, then 201 mm square. So this you should keep it by heart for 12, 16, 20 and 25 dia rods. Okay, 491 mm square is the AST for 25 mm dia rod. So depending upon that, how many 25 dia rods you have to provide for this AST that we have got. Okay, we have all covered this in detail in our coursework. Okay, so this is how you calculate. Just an overview I have given is, just keep, prepare a table for 12 dia rod, what is the AST? 16 dia rod, what is the AST in mm square? So if it is 724, how many number of rods you have to use? That AST into number of rods gives you the number of rods to be provided for this AST. Okay, got it? Okay. So next is the sizing of frame members. So these are some of the important things that you should be aware of on sizing the members. Normally you can do a design, model a building, do an analysis in a software, take the output, and you can come up with this AST like this in StatPro or ETAPS, and you can arrive at the arrive at the number of rods. Okay, that is the normal design procedure. Now, before that, you have to size the columns and beams. Okay, and when you are doing it for a seismic design, you should take special care, and you have to follow all the main clauses that needs to be followed in IS 1893. Okay, so in this case, how you will do the sizing of frame members? So as I said, mostly the beam should be of same sizes. Please don't alter the depth of the beam, and there should not be any offset. Okay, so for a proper structural behavior, the beam should be of same sizes throughout the bay. If you are designing, if the critical case is seismic, that is the earthquake force, and there should not be no offset. And if the span is longer than 6 to 7 meters, then you should design in such a way that the depth of the beam is controlled by gravity. And if there is a shorter span of 6 meters, then as per this clause 7.11.1.1, you have an inter-story drift. I will show you that code spec 7.1.11.1, right? It comes here, 7.11.1.11.1. So if you see, there is an internal load 7.11.11.1. So this is where the clause says that there will be an internal internal coefficient factor that needs to be considered for story drift. Okay, this 7.11.1.1, it specifies which 11.1.1. Here it is specified that you have to consider a partial load factor of 1. Okay, so this needs to be considered while you are considering the, yeah. So while you are considering this, for shorter spans less than 6 meters, that needs to be considered. So if you are providing a longitudinal bar arrangement, it should be adequate for that beam as per IS 456. Okay, and also one more thing you have to take care is the lap splicing. I think you might be aware of the lap length when one reinforcement, total reinforcement is 12 meters of length. So when you are providing another reinforcement, if your beam is of span 30 meters and you, in that case, you have to lap two 12 meter reinforcement rods at one position, right? So you have to follow that lap length depending upon the IS code. That is a main criteria that lap splicing needs to be followed. And also, if you take this important points that needs to be remembered is the maximum distance between the bars, at least 100 to 120 mm needs to be maintained, and minimum distance is 60 mm. And as per clause IS 613.920, if the beam to depth ratio, beam span to depth ratio is greater than 5, then the beams tends to brittle it off. So you should also be take special care on the beam span to depth ratio. And also in the beam column junction, 50 mm, if you take the beams and the column, say if you have a beam and a column, column must be 50 mm, at least minimum of 50 mm wider than the beam. So it should not be like column is shorter and beam is, the width of the beam is higher. Okay, it should not like covering the column outer. It is not, it is said that the reinforcement of the beam should not go outside the column. So you should ensure that 50 mm width of the column should be higher than the beam. Okay, and detailing of beam longitudinal reinforcement as per 13.9.20, these are the main facts that needs to be kept in mind. That is, you have to provide a maximum spacing of links in region where splicing occurs. That is the lap length that I was talking about. And there should be a minimum lap length that needs to be provided. And lapping should be provided to a certain distance from the face of the column that helps to prevent the formation of plastic hinge at the end of the beams. Okay, and not more than 50% of top and bottom steel bars are to be lapped at any one of the section. So you should take special care on the lapping positions. And according to IS 13.9.20, you should also provide minimum of 2 rods of 12 mm dia at the top and bottom faces. You should ensure that you have to provide 2 rods of 12 mm dia, and also minimum longitudinal steel ratio should satisfy this Pmax formula, 0.25 root FCK by FI, and maximum longitudinal steel ratio for any section should be 0.025. Okay, and this is how the shear reinforcement that I was talking, sorry, ductile reinforcement needs to be provided. Okay, if you see, the stirrup should be closely spaced at the supports, which will confine to the concrete, and this helps in the longitudinal bars of buckling of the longitudinal bars. And also the concrete members are brittle in shear, right? So once they reach their shear resistance, they before yielding in flexure, so this they suffer a drastic and sudden drop in resistance after this peak. So the closely spaced links enhance the ductility at the end of the beams, and plastic hinge action is also expected there. So that is why we have to provide, while providing ductile reinforcement, only at the ends the spacing between the stirrups will be so small. That is only they will be providing less than 100 mm or 100, not too much, not 250 mm center to center spacing and all. So this ductile detailing needs to be followed as per 13920. And shear failure in members depends, and this helps in the shear failure also, okay, in the beams. And if you see the detailing rule as per IS 13920 clause 13, these are some of the specifications that are listed. If I show you the code, it will be in a detailed form where I have just taken the points for showing it to you. If you see this code, 6.3, right? So if you take this 6.3, these are some of the detailing codes that you need to follow. See the web reinforcement, how it has to be. The hook length, hook should be 135 degree and not less than 75 mm, 10 by 10 diameter. So these you should ensure that you follow it. How should be the longitudinal reinforcement? What is the lap splice that needs to be provided? Where it to be provided? So these are the criteria I said, no? So these, see, if you see the corner of the beam, here it is really congested. And this is what I said, two bars should be provided for two, full length at the top and bottom. And this at the corners, there will be 2D hoop spacing distance. And this is what, greater than D by 2. So these are the specification that the ductiling detailing that you have to follow. Ductile detailing you have to follow. Okay. And this is what I have noted it in a bullets, that the inclination of the bar should be inclined or vertical and should not be greater than 135 degree should be, angle of the hook should be followed as 135 degree, and minimum length of the hook should be embedded into the concrete core, and minimum diameter of the link should be followed, and minimum spacing of links at the end of the bars of the beams, like stirrups should be followed, and maximum distance of the closely spaced links from the face of the column. All these needs to be followed as per clause 6.3. Coming to the size of the columns, sizing of the columns, you have to size the columns in such a way that to ensure the minimum flexural ductility of the column as per IS 13920. That sets the upper limit on its axial load ratio. So what is the axial load acting on it, and how you have to calculate the ductility of that column required. And also the factored axial compressive stress shall not exceed 0.4 FCK. Okay, and as per clause 7.1.1 in IS 13920, there are some points that needs to be followed for minimum dimensioning of column shall not be less than 20 dB, where dB is the diameter of the largest longitudinal reinforcement bar in the beam passing through the column at the joint. So these are some of the ductile detailing requirements and on sizing of the columns, and it should not be less than 300 mm. These are main points that you have to consider. And how you come up with the stiffness of the reinforced concrete members. So the axial force is negligible in RC beams. So LE value is taken as constant. And axial force is directly proportional to cracking of RC columns. Okay, so this is how the axial force on columns is considered for ductile design, and the detailing part is covered as per clause 7.1.1 in IS 1390. So these are the points that you need to follow during the concept stage on sizing of columns. So these are some of the beam ranges that I have listed down for beams and columns. What should be the gross section, gross area of section, that is AG, and what will be the moment of inertia, that is the recommended value for rectangular beams, T and L beams, columns. I've taken this from again from the Codal norms, and I've just listed down the ranges and the recommended values that you need to consider. Okay, so this is what the effective moment of inertia, that is the LE, how to calculate the LE according to IS 1893 for columns, beams and walls. And and if you're going on with a soft story mechanism that is developed in a frame system, then top and bottom ends of the columns in a story will yield opposite bending. So you have to take that beam column joint and the column junction should be stronger than 40% than the beams. So you, while if it is a soft story mechanism that you have, you are coming up, then the column should be really stronger by 40%, really more than 40% than beams. Okay, so these are some of the points because while doing the concept design, these are the things you have to consider in mind to design the columns. Okay, and if you take the longitudinal reinforcement, this also have taken it for and it varies for columns and beams. Okay, if you take a circular columns, there should be a minimum of six bars, and rectangular columns means minimum of 8 bars, 4 bars in the corner and 4 bars should be placed in the middle of the column. So I don't know whether I can. No, I can't use the whiteboard here. Okay, so it is like 4 columns in the corner and mid, in between that 4 columns should be provided. So as per IS 456/2000, the minimum cross sectional area of longitudinal steel and gross sectional should is 0.8% of the gross sectional area of column. Okay, so these points also needs to be considered, and you should not go for bars of less than 12 mm dia for columns. Okay, so if you are for seismic design, you should ensure that the bar size of the bar should not go less than 12 mm for columns. And these criteria of 6 columns and 8 bars in rectangular also needs to be followed. And if you feel that your AST is not that much required, then you can reduce the number of rods and you can come up with 12 mm dia rods, and you can place in such a way the 4 columns of the corner are covered for a rectangular or square column, and minimum reinforcement in the center of the columns. Okay, so how to provide splicing for longitudinal reinforcement? I told you, right, if the splicing needs to be considered, and special care needs to be considered when you are connecting 2 reinforcement bars. Okay, so if for lap splicing, closed links must be provided over the entire length over which the longitudinal bars are one which we are providing for beams, and vertical bars are which one which we are providing for columns. And spacing of link should not exceed 150 mm along the splice length, and lap length shall not be less than the development length, that is 50 dB. Okay, so this LD distance, so that also needs to be followed, and lap splices should be provided only in the center half of the clear column. Okay, that also you need to consider, and special care needs to be taken for that. And what is a transverse reinforcement? Transverse reinforcement is nothing, that it is in the form of mesh or additional loose bars is required in a composite beam. Or why transverse beam is provided in a beam is to resist the diagonal tension due to transverse shear. So to hold the longitudinal reinforcement in position and to prevent or delay the sudden collapse or and impart necessary ductility of the members is where we are providing this transverse reinforcement. And again, the same point is what I have repeated again and again is the bend. The bend is the important part that needs to be
provided. This 135 degree bend is what you need to follow, and the shear minimum shear reinforcement. If you are using a 32 mm dia rod, then the shear reinforcement should not be less than 8 mm. And if you are going more than 32 mm dia rod, then the shear reinforcement should not be less than 10 mm dia. Okay, so this is a mandatory one, and there are some special confining reinforcement that needs to be provided for ductility as per IS 3920. That is over a length of 1 meter from each joint towards mid span and on either side of any section where flexural yielding may occur under the effect of earthquake forces, you have to provide a special confining reinforcement. And these reinforcement bars are of tensile principle stresses that are expected to develop ignoring the concrete. And if you take in the compressive principle stress area, you have to compare both the concrete and the rebar, and you have to provide ties to restrain these bars against buckling. Okay, and for special confining reinforcement, these are some of the points that you need to consider: that 1/4 of the minimum member dimension of the beam or column, and six times diameter of the smallest longitudinal bars. So if you are providing a 12 mm dia rod and 16 mm dia rod, then 12 mm dia rod, six times the 12 mm dia rod, or six times the 10 mm dia rod, that the lowest dia rod you are providing, you should come with a special confining reinforcement on that. And 100 mm spacing between the links needs to be provided. So this is how we have to provide ductile detailing as per IS codes. So I think I made clear on the detailing part. So now I will just answer your queries on a stretch so that you get more clarity on that. Okay, I'm just going to the chat. So I think, so guys, if you have any queries, you want to understand the percentage of AST in economical and uneconomical. So see, the economical design and uneconomical design is something that you are designing, right? If you got an AST of 1800, so what is mm square I'm talking about is nothing. Pi by 4 d square is how you will come up with the 12 dia rod. I'll just show you, because I'm not prepared any sheet for that. So I will just take this new slide, and I will show you for 12 mm dia rod. Okay, 12 mm dia rod. It is pi by 4 d square. That is 3.14 into 12 square. How much you get? 113 something. 112.9 something like that. So 3.14. into 12 divide by 4, 113. This is what the mm square for 12 mm dia. And how about 16? 3.14 into 16 into 16 divide by 4. That is 201. So for this, you have to keep in memory, for 16 mm, it is, I just showed you, okay, mm square. For 20 mm, it is 314 mm square. 25, it is 491 mm square. So my AST is 1800 mm square, required AST for beams. So I am providing four numbers of 25 mm dia rod, which is, if you see, 4 into 491 is 1964. Okay, so this is 1964 here in this mm square. So in this, this is 164 mm square I am providing in the higher limit. Okay, so if it is 1900, then this is more than sufficient. This is more. You can go on with four numbers of 25. If it is 1600 mm square is what the AST required. This is the AST required is what I am playing now. Okay. So that if 1600 is the AST required, you can just think of providing two numbers of 25 in some places and four numbers of 20. You can just it should not go beyond 100 mm square. There should not be a difference of 100 mm square on AST, because the more you provide steel also, no, it increases the cost of the project. It also increases the failure of the structure. If you provide a massive structure also, the structure gets failed immediately without any indication. Okay, so this is the main AST numbers that you have to keep in mind. You can just keep till 32 mm dia, because we don't go beyond 32 mm in many projects. Only if it is of bridges and something like that, then only you will go on for heavier reinforcement. So this 12 mm means 113 mm square, 16 mm means 201 mm square, 220 mm it is. So from these numbers, the AST, from the AST, how many number of diode rods you have to provide, you can calculate. This is IS456 that I have opened, and this is what the load combinations that I am talking about. If you see, the load combinations is always dead load plus live load. IL is the imposed load, okay? Dead load plus imposed load, dead load plus wind load, dead load plus wind load plus imposed load plus wind load. And in another case only, you will be considering without wind load, you will be considering the same combination. If you see here, while considering earthquake effects, substitute earthquake load for wind load. So in no case you will be considering both in earthquake load and wind load. Okay, if you are considering wind load, you will neglect the earthquake load. If it is the combination, in no case you will consider dead load plus earthquake load plus wind load. Got it? So this is what the load factors. So this is 1.5, this is 0.9. So this is a load factor, this is a limit state of collapse, and this is a limit state of serviceability. So this is the load factor that we have. So always we have a cushion of load factor while we are designing. So don't worry that the building will get collapsed if you are reducing the reinforcement, or if you are reducing the size of the column. So provide the sufficient required size and reinforcement as per the design. That will come up with a very good design. Okay, so that will be the economical design. If you take the Masters in Design program, I have taken the courses from this only. Today you saw analysis and design of high-rise building using seismic forces, right? So this, I have just taken only two modules in this. In this coursework, you'll be learning in detail, in depth into the concepts of earthquake engineering. What is a response spectrum analysis? What is the time period analysis? How to calculate all this? And in this coursework, you will be taking up of 8 softwares knowledge: AutoCAD, Revit, ETAP, SAFE, StatPro, Tekla Structural Designer, Ramstad Connections, which is a important software that you have to know about for connection design, steel connection designs. You will be learning composite structures, tensile structures. Tensile structures is a new kind of structure that is coming up now in the construction industry, and you will be learning design of tanks, how to design a tank in plate element using plate modeling in StatPro. And there are many master's program for if you are really interested in bridge design, or if you are really interested in metro via structures of precast and pre-stressed. You have a master's certification program in industrial structures. And if you want to go through the analysis, you have a course on mastering in shear force and bending moment. So if you go to our website, you can see n number of courses that we are offering. And all our courses are in-depth into the concepts. It is like we help you work on projects which are industry relevant, and you will get an opportunity and you will gain more knowledge on working on these projects. If you see, I will show you some of the projects that my students have worked on, so that you will get an clarity. This student is one of the student of our master's program, master's in HRB program. And you can see the projects that he had done. So this student, see, he had done starting from concrete mixed design. He had done AutoCAD. These are all the projects that he had done in AutoCAD. If you see AutoCAD, we will take you in depth. See, this is a project he has done by himself using AutoCAD software. So if you see the other coursework, Revit also we have covered 4 modules: Navis Work, 3D rendering, Dynamo, which is widely used for he has developed a sinusoidal curve using parametric stadium model. These are all the projects that he have done for ETABS. How to calculate the stiffness, how to position the columns in ETABS. Before I covered you the concept stage, right? So this is how they have to do the analysis. And finally, he had done an analysis of a hostel building in Assam. So this is how the detailed report that he has shared once completing the project, how the codes he had referred, how he had done it in ETABS, and how he had come up with the detailing part, see the AST requirement, how he had calculated it and applied it for column and beam, and finally the substructure design. So all the courses is not limited to the superstructure design. It is of combination of superstructure and substructure design. Okay, so it is more into and we also cover design of shallow. Somebody was asking for a foundation design course. So we have taught him the foundation design course. See how detailed he had done a manual calculation by himself. So these are how he had provided the reinforcement. So this gives the URL link will be shared in his resume. So when he is applying for a job, the opportunity of him getting a job is higher. The chance of getting him a job is higher. This is the ETABS course that he had done. He is still on the study of connection designs. He is a potential candidate that he is doing our master's program. We have more than 275 students who have already enrolled for HRB, that is high-rise building masters. More than 25 students who have enrolled for bridge masters, precast masters, and also for industrial buildings. So we have mainly conducted this demo to help you understand how our courses at Skillink are, how depth you will get a knowledge on learning these courses. So we are always providing a proper support to the students, and once you have enrolled in the coursework, you will be allocated with a support engineer who is experienced designing these concepts, and they will be guiding you throughout the coursework. Understood. So it is like whenever you get an query, you can always reach out to them at any point of time, because they are reachable 24/7 to clarify your queries. So they will be assisting you throughout the course. It is not that you learn from the recordings. So all the courses that we offer are from industrial experts. So I have around 15 to 16 years of experience in the design field. So that is how my thought process on teaching is. So like the same way, all the instructors have the same 15 to 16 years of experience in the design field. And if you feel that the support engineer who is assisting you is not providing a proper support, then you can always request for a support session. It is just that this is how our website will look like. And when you will be providing with a credential, where you will be provided with a login ID through which you can log in into your Skillink. Once you have enrolled into the coursework, you can log in into your you can log in into your dashboard using the one-time password that you receive all the time. Okay, so this is my how my dashboard will look like. So if you go to my dashboard, you can access the videos from where here. We have a separate forums. And if you have any queries, you can just create a ticket here using this option. You can also request for a one-to-one session with the instructor. And we also have many, many new courses like tensile structures using Doolable, which is a new software, roadway design that is exclusively for road designs, bridges, industrial structures. So these two courses is what I took an overview for you. So there are many courses that we have come up with. You can just go to our website, just have a look at that, and you can upskill your knowledge joining and enrolling in this coursework.